he has as his under his supervision. Also, I would like to congratulate sir, especially because recently he has received a patent under his credit. So that's a really very much congratulations to you, sir. And so with this brief introduction, I would like to hand over the session to Vipul Khairat, sir. So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Chandni. Thank you for the kind words and wonderful introduction. But as I always say, this is, I mean, okay, don't go by that profile and think that, you know, all those who are listening or attending this talk, I'm just a few years earlier into the field, and that's why I have had some experience of working with LabVIEW, which I'll be sharing with you, right? Don't go by those things, yeah. All right, so am I audible? Mic check, all set? Camera?
Yes, sir,
set?
Perfect.
Yes. Okay. Yes, sir. Okay, yeah, thank you. All right, so LabVIEW, how many candidates, how many you know, attendees do we have?
33 okay, have joined.
33 including me. Okay. Okay.
Yes,
so first of all, I want to know how many of you have you know, seen or used LabVIEW. Like, can you please raise your hand if you have ever used LabVIEW? One, Shail. Okay, Shail madam. All right. Anyone else? Soumya has done it. Chandni has done it. Okay. Yeah. I'll share my screen so that you can see what I'm seeing on screen. Just a second. Your entire screen. All right. That's it. Only three or four people have worked with LabVIEW. So that's encouraging. Like, you know, that will make me feel that I'm teaching something new to you. And how many of you are PhD students? Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Dhanadhan bad rahe. Good. Quite a few. Very good. So quite a few of you are PhD students. Other, I believe, are probably into your masters, or some of you are faculty. All right. That's okay. That's great. Now, okay, let's first introduce what LabVIEW is. Thank you. Yeah, you can lower your hand now. Yeah, quite a few, almost 50% of you. Thank you. Now, you know, the first two sessions today, basically this entire STTP is about computational tools for physics, right? So I assume that all of us are doing physics by some or the other means, either in experiments or in theory or in simulations. And to do this physics, to do the science, we generally deal with data. And the first two sessions today were dedicated to the analysis of data, right? How do you kind of, you know, make sense of what data you have? How do you make a meaningful conclusion out of your data? How do you present your data more you know, meaningfully or more attractively? And that is what origin. Now, today, what we are going to see is how do we acquire data? Like, how do we actually take the data from our experiment, right? And in many cases, we use some sort of interfacing techniques, some way of, you know, connecting the instruments with the computer. And LabVIEW is one such platform where you can do it easily. You don't need to be a programmer. You don't need to be an engineer or a, you know, software expert or a hardware expert to be able to connect your instruments with your computer, take the data, and then also analyze the data. So you may choose to go with Origin Pro or Origin Lab, or you may simply, you know, analyze the data using just a simple programming language the way you do it with MATLAB or any other thing in LabVIEW itself. So LabVIEW kind of, you know, gives you multiple features, but the main purpose, the main objective of LabVIEW is data acquisition. How do you connect your instruments with your computer? And then how do you acquire the data? So I have three talks in this STTP. First one is today, and then the two more to come in the next day. So what I have planned is the first talk will purely be an introductory one where I will just introduce LabVIEW, how it looks like, what are the various tools to do the programming. And it is very similar to any other programming language, right? So if you have worked with any other programming language, you will easily be able to understand what I'm going to show you today. And then tomorrow, the two talks will be distributed, mostly about the interfacing part. So I have divided into it. I have divided them in two different sessions. One will be about the image processing, where how do we, I'll show you how I acquire or how we acquire the images and then process it to make some meaningful outcome, meaningful extractions of informations. And the second one will be for real instruments, which can, detect some signals, either the photo detector signals or some of spectroscopy signals. We will detect, we will read the values and try to plot and make some analysis of it, right? So today we will learn or see how the LabVIEW looks like, what are the tools available with us, particularly for programming in LabVIEW. And tomorrow we will see the interfacing part, where we will see the image processing. And second one is interfacing some real instruments like Locking Amplifier and all. So I'll show you a demo of how I communicate to Locking Amplifier on my LabVIEW program, using my LabVIEW program, and how do I command a monochromator or how do I command my Locking Amplifier, set its configuration, and then measure the data, right? So LabVIEW is more about measurements. LabVIEW is more about acquisition of data. The later part, the analysis of the data, can be done on LabVIEW, or you can use any other software, any other analyzer to do the analysis part, right? So this is how the talk is planned. So let's see how it looks like. Okay, we'll first go to the PPT. And I'll present it. My screen is visible, right? All right. So the title of the talk is Applications in Scientific and Computation and Interfacing. So LabVIEW, like how do I use LabVIEW for my scientific computations as well as interfacing? And the other part is covered. So this is my outline of the talk. We will first have an introduction of this entire virtual instrumentation system. So this is something new. Like, virtual instrumentation is basically a new concept. It has evolved drastically over the last 15 years, and it's something everybody is using, whether it is in theory or simulation, mostly experimental physics, that too, particularly at a bigger scales, require such virtual instrumentations. And we will see how virtual instrumentation is done. What are the components? Then we will see the LabVIEW as a tool to do the virtual instrumentation, right? So LabVIEW basically facilitates the virtual instrumentation. So we will see how the LabVIEW helps us. Particularly, we'll talk about these three questions: what is LabVIEW, why should we use it, and how do we use it? And then how part is then divided into multiple subsections. Like, we'll see the terminology used in LabVIEW. We'll see certain specific tools which are very useful to for the scientific programming. Some of the techniques which are very specific to LabVIEW generally are not required in other programming languages, but you require in LabVIEW. And finally, I'll show you some examples, as I said, maybe some image processing examples or some real-time data acquisition examples. All right. And particularly this test cases, I have chosen, as I said, to cover a couple of major things. Mostly I'll talk about the image processing. How do we kind of, read an image using a programming language, and then how do we implement some algorithms, like genetic algorithms, to design various applications. And finally, the real-time interfacing and talking to instrument through LabVIEW. So these are the three test cases which we will discuss tomorrow, not today. Today we will just talk about the basic part of LabVIEW, how it is used, and what are the features available. All right, so let's first introduce the virtual instrumentation. My screen is visible, right? The slides are visible, Channi, properly?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So what is virtual instrument? Basically, you want to use PC as an instrument. You want your computer to be an instrument. Why? Simple. It's not that your PC will replace an instrument. Your PC will facilitate it, right? But basically, you can have multiple instruments. Mostly, all the physics experiments are basically some combinations of sensors and actuators, right? There are some sensors which are taking the measurements. There are some actuators which activate something, which triggers some event. So basically, you trigger some event and you measure the response. This is a very fundamental part of any experiment. You trigger and then you observe. You trigger and then you measure. So all the physics experiments, all the scientific experiments are a combination of sensors and actuators, right? Now, sensors could be some temperature sensor, it could be some pressure sensor, strain gauge, or any other sensor, right? I mean, if it is a high energy particle physics experiment, then you have various detectors, some, you know, scintillation detectors and some particle detectors, event detectors, which would look for some sort of scintillation, some bright spot or some bright glow and something like that, right? Mostly the particle detectors, which would typically be photo detectors or a secondary photo detector. I mean, you understand what I mean. Basically, there are different types of detectors that will be involved. And then there will be some events, right? There are some solenoid valves which are creating an event, which are triggering an event. And then you are detecting and measuring the responses or the outcomes of the event. So all the experiments are basically the actuators, which would trigger something, and then sensors, which would observe and measure the responses from the system. Now, your computer cannot do it. Like, your computer cannot be a photo detector. Your computer cannot be a solenoid valve. But you want your computer to control everything and then make the computer one instrument that has all those controls on your panel, right? So this is what virtual instrumentation means. You have all the controls of your experiment, because experiment is made up of several different things. So you want all the controls of your experiment on a single panel on your computer, and then you want them to be synchronized in certain logic, right? By some logic. So you make a program that will synchronize various instruments, various sensors and actuators, and then the entire thing will look like a single instrument on your monitor, on your computer. So this is what virtual instrumentation is all about. You have the sensors, you have the actuators, combine them all, talk to all of them, and then synchronize them so that you create an event and then measure the responses of a system or from the system as a result of those triggers. Right. Why should we use it? Because one, it is user defined, right? I mean, I am defining my instrument. I decide how many controls do I want, at what time which controls should trigger, and at what time which sensor should read. So basically, an entire experiment is controlled and is defined by user. And then, you know, that entire instrument subsequently is designed by the user, right? So for example, suppose you buy a voltmeter, right? A voltmeter. Then the voltmeter is measuring the voltage at two point, across the two points. But that is it. Like, then suppose you want to do an experiment, either you do it the way you do it in MSc or in your lab, where you continuously keep logging it in your book, right? You measure the voltage and write it down, then change the current, measure the voltage, write it down. So this is one way. But then instead of that, you can have some controlled way of changing the current and then measuring the voltage and do it on your computer. So you define your instruments which you want to be you want to have in your experiment, and then you define their sequences, like at what time which event will take place and what measurement will I carry or will I do. So it is user defined and user designed instrument, right? I am designing it. Then brings all the lab instruments on a single table. This is also very important, because for example, the spectroscopy experiment that I'll show you tomorrow, I have several components. Like, I have a monochromator, I have lock-in amplifier, I have detectors, and I want all of them on a single platform where I am talking to all of them simultaneously, and every instrument is responding to my command from the single location. So brings all the lab instruments on a single table. Then functional flexibility. Suppose today I am using a lock-in amplifier, a monochromator, and a light source to do a transmission reflection measurements, right? So I have aligned them, I have done the optics part, and now I have connected all these instruments using the LabVIEW and made a virtual instrument which measures the transmission reflections for my samples. Tomorrow I want to do an electroluminescence experiment with the same setup, right? Because same setup can do it. So I don't have to buy a new experiment. I don't have to buy a new instrument to do that. Just I will change my program to change the sequence of triggers, and then my measurement will be slightly different, right? So the same instrument, the same setup with those lakhs of rupees of fund, can do multiple tasks by just some minor changes in the program. So I have functional flexibility. The same instrument can today do the transmission spectroscopy for me. tomorrow the same instrument can be the photoluminescence spectroscopy, right? Otherwise, if I go to the market and buy a you know, different spectroscopies, like if I buy a transmission reflection spectroscopic instrument, that will cost me about 4 lakh rupees or so. And then if I buy a photoluminescence spectroscopy, depending on what light source etc. I choose, it might cost me around 6, 7, 8 lakh rupees separately, right? So if you have the lab view and if you're using the virtual instrumentation concept, then you can do these two things using the same set of instruments and have the functional flexibility. You can use your setup or the entire system to do the transmission reflection today, and the same setup will be doing the photoluminescence tomorrow, right? And that's a huge flexibility, particularly when you have the fund crisis, right? Then the last part is like acquisition, analysis, and presentation can all done together on the same platform. So as I said, you have the Origin Lab, which can do the analysis, scientific analysis of data very carefully, very accurately. But suppose you are acquiring data on LabVIEW platform, you don't necessarily go to that other software, like the third party software. The LabVIEW itself can do it for you. All the programming and numerical and arithmetic and logical operations that you want to carry out on your data are available in LabVIEW itself. And so, you know, almost everything, like the curve fitting, the peak analysis, you know, the data analysis, all sort of data analysis tools are available in LabVIEW itself. And you can simply, you know, acquire the data and analyze it there itself. And then the presentation part, the graphing, the plotting, etc., is also available. So the acquisition, analysis, and presentations can all be done together on a single platform, right? So these are the things that basically, you know, offer, I mean, these are the things that are offered by LabVIEW. And so, you know, you can have a nice virtual instrumentation, virtual instrument in your lab that can do multiple tasks with limited resources. What do we need? What do we need to make a virtual instrument? Obviously, a computer. I need a computer to do the virtual instrumentation, because that's what I want, right? I want my PC, my personal computer, as an instrument. So I want a personal computer. I need a transducer. Now, some of the transducers, right? As I said, all the experiments are basically sensors and actuators. So all the sensors and actuators are transducers, right? Transducer kya hota hai? Sabko pata hai na? What is transducer? अच्छा मुझे सॉरी मैं जैसे क्लास में लेता हूँ वैसे ही कर रहा हूँ अभी मैं आई हैव दिस हैबिट ऑफ आस्किंग क्वेश्चंस आई होप यू वोंट माइंड इट कैन समवन टेल मी व्हाट ट्रांसड्यूसर इज
सर इलेक्ट्रिक सिग्नल इज कन्वर्ट इनटू द ऑडियो सिग्नल
इलेक्ट्रिक सिग्नल कन्वर्टेड इनटू ऑडियो सिग्नल इज ट्रांसड्यूसर ओके एनीथिंग एल्स एनीवन एल्स व्हाट इज ट्रांसड्यूसर
An instrument which converts one form of energy to another form.
Very good, Karthikeyan. Yeah, the instrument that converts one form of energy into the other is transducer. Very good. Yes, wonderful. Anything else? Yeah, I think it is covered. Very good. Thank you, both Soumya and Karthikeyan. Basically, transducer is something that converts any physical parameter into electrical signal and vice versa, mainly electrical, particularly, you know, it's not any form of energy, but particularly electrical form of energy, because that is the way we measure the signal, right? Almost all the measurements are done using electrical signals, either current or voltage. So any physical parameter needs to be converted into electrical signal and vice versa. So the transducer is one device. Transducer is a device that converts physical parameter into electrical signal or electrical signal into physical parameter, right? For example, the microphone, this microphone is converting sound into electrical signal, right? The camera is converting the vision, the actual images into electrical signal. So all these are transducers. This microphone is a transducer, camera is a transducer, everything, you know, a thermocouple measures temperature, so it basically converts heat into equivalent electrical signal, right? So for example, heater converts electrical signal into heat. So all these instruments, all these devices which convert any physical parameter into equivalent electrical signal and vice versa are called transducer. So to do this virtual instrumentation, you need such transducer, right? Apart from personal computer, you need such transducers depending on what experiment you are performing. Suppose you are doing spectroscopy, you want to convert light into electrical signal, photocurrent basically. So the photodiode is a transducer. Similarly, you also want to generate the light of different frequency or different wavelength, right? So your light source, which is controlled by electrical signal, is also a transducer. So transducer mainly is something that converts physical parameter into electrical signal and vice versa. After converting the physical parameter into electrical signal, you also need to do the signal conditioning, right? So you need signal conditioning to carry out virtual instrumentations based experiments. Now, signal conditioning basically means removal of noise, making useful, meaningful signals or information, and then analyzing it. So signal conditioning is generally amplification. Signal conditioning is removal of noise, and signal conditioning is filtering. You might have lots of different signals, but you want to extract some useful signal out of all this. For example, if it is spectroscopy, you have all the ambience light also getting into the photodetector. So to avoid that, you are doing it in a dark room to avoid the ambience light, but even with that, some light will always be present. To remove that light, you put a filter which basically, some sort of bandpass filter or cutoff filter, which would remove the unwanted part of the signals, right? So signal conditioning mainly is made up of three parts: the noise tackling, right? You remove the noise, you amplify the signal, and third, you filter the signal. So you filter out the unwanted part of the signal. Noise cancellation can be considered as filtering, but there are two different things. One is the noise, which is present even at your signal frequency, and then there are noises which are very clearly avoidable. For example, the 50 hertz AC creates lots of noise in your data, so you can easily remove those 50 hertz signal from your measurements, right? So this is all covered in the signal conditioning, and signal conditioning is an essential part of any virtual instrument. Then you have the DAQ hardware. So DAQ hardware is, after the conditioning, you need to convert it into digital form, right? So because your transducer is, suppose if microphone is a transducer, it is collecting the voice and is converting into electrical signal, which you condition using some sort of amplifier and filter. But after that, your computer only understands the digital part, only understands the binary version of your signal, ones and zeros. So you need to most of the time convert it into the digital form. So there would be some analog to digital converter, and then in the reverse process you require a digital to analog converter. So DAQ is mostly made up of some A2D and D2A converters, and then you need a software to basically control all this on your computer. So any virtual instrument is made up of these five things: a computer, some transducers, some signal conditioning electronics, some DAQ hardwares like digital to analog and analog digital converter, and a software, right? And software will mostly be the LabVIEW. The major control and synchronization part will be done on LabVIEW. However, there are other softwares also. There are third-party softwares also you can call in LabVIEW. And so there can be different types of softwares. So these five things together: a computer, transducers, signal conditioning electronics, DAQ electronics, and softwares together make a virtual instrument. Right. So this is how a virtual instrumentation is done. Okay. This diagram explains everything. You have a transducer, some sort of sensors which senses either pressure or sound or light, some way of measuring the physical parameter, right? That is being conditioned. So the noise is removed from it, the signal is amplified, the unwanted part of the signal is filtered out, and that is then converted into digital equivalent. And then digital equivalent of that signal is read by a computer and processed by a software, right? I don't know why I'm using this floppy disk symbol for software. There's no point. I mean, floppy disks are gone now. But you know what I mean, right? It's a software that controls everything. So this is a typical virtual instrument. This is how it looks like. You have the transducer, the signal conditioner, the DAQ hardware, and a computer. And finally, the software that controls everything. All right, too much to ask for? Not really. I'll explain. This is not very difficult. I'll show you some examples where everything is done very easily, and probably a lot of thing is done by us even in our day-to-day life, right? This is an actual example, actual photograph of a similar system, this was an MSC experiment, I'll tell you. This is not a very hi-fi experiment, a very simple experiment where we are measuring the IV characteristic of a diode. Right? Now, measuring IV characteristic of a diode could be a very basic MSC or BSc level experiment. It could be an advanced level experiment as well, because even at a very higher level, advanced level of research, if you are into device physics or if you are into semiconductor devices, then you need to do this IV characteristics of diodes even at advanced level. For example, you know, if you are into solar cell physics, then the solar cell is also a diode, and you need to take an IV characteristic of sticks of solar cell quite often. Or if you are into LED or lasers, those are also diodes, and you need to do the IV characteristics. So that could be an advanced level research. But at the same time, you know, the IV characteristic of a transistor or diode could be a very basic BSc level experiment. And this was done for MSc students and by MSc students. So I'll tell you this experiment, very simple, very easy. You have a beaker filled with ice. So this, and then there is a test tube. There are a few wires going into the test tube, which are basically giving the current and measuring voltage. So there are four wires, four probes. Two are passing the current through a diode. And then the other two are also parallelly connected, which measures the voltage across the diode. There are some current limiting resistance. Everything is there in this test tube, right? So your diode is placed at the bottom of the test tube. And then this beaker, I guess you can see my cursor also, because I'm rotating or kind of, you know, moving my cursor on the screen. I'm sure it will be visible. So this beaker has the diode and those connections inside a test tube, which is surrounded by the ice. And then a thermocouple is also placed along with this diode. So the thermocouple measures the temperature of the diode. And then we can measure the temperature. You know, if you have the ice well placed, and we also used to put some silica gel, so that the silica gel near the diode, so that the moisture condensation can be avoided. But as I said, this is an MSc level experiment or BSc level experiment, so done at very scarce resources and a very simple one. Now, you know, this thermocouple will tell me the temperature, and we used to go up to about 5 degrees Celsius, right? The ice is at 0 degrees Celsius. With a lot of ice cubes around, the temperature at the center of this test tube used to go up to 5, 7, 6 degrees Celsius. So at that temperature, we will start the experiment. Then we can slowly turn on this Jugadu technology, right? This is an iron, the press, which we use in our homes. I have just, you know, inverted it. This was done by me, I mean, when I was doing PhD, very old experiment. So this works as a hot plate. This slowly increases the temperature. The thermocouple measures the temperature. And then there's a computer program that takes an IV characteristic after every 2 or 3 or 5 degrees Celsius rise. So that can be controlled by a program. So I say that, okay, measure an IV characteristic at every 5 degrees Celsius change. It starts from 5 degrees. So first measurement will be done at 5 degrees. Then the temperature is slowly increasing. The moment it reaches 10 degrees Celsius, again an IV curve will be taken, will be measured at 15, at 20, 25, 30, and this can go up to around 80 degrees Celsius. So from 5 degrees Celsius to 80 degrees Celsius, we can have an IV curve of a diode in our lab, automatically taken after every some amount of time, right? And that can be programmed. So once I start the experiment, maybe after half an hour or so, at the end of the experiment, I will have an IV curve of the diode starting from 5 degrees Celsius all the way up to 80 degrees Celsius, right? Because this water will also increase. I mean, after the ice has molten to water, it will continue to rise the temperature up to 80, 85 degrees Celsius. It can go up to 100 also, but then it will start boiling and may create some issues. So we used to go up to 80, and entire thing was automated. So this iron will be turned off the moment it reaches the 80 degrees Celsius, and then the experiment will be over. The analysis will also be done. The IV curve will be fit using experimental equations. You know, we know the diode equation. And from that, as a function of temperature, we have the data. So we can measure the ideality factor. We can measure the temperature coefficients and activation and energy of the material. A lot of things can be extracted by just taking the IV curve of diode at different intervals of temperature. Now, this is an example of an actual virtual instrumentation system, and I'll show you all those five components, right? You can see a personal computer, very old one, when we used to have those big monitor, right? So this is a personal computer. The transducers are basically a few things. Like there's a heater, which is transducer. There's a thermocouple, which is transducer, right? Then there's a current source and voltmeter, which is transducer. So all those are transducers, which are lying somewhere near this setup or somehow connected. This black box is signal conditioner. So it measures the signal and amplifies wherever required, controls the current and voltage. And so the, you know, current limiting and current conditioning, the measurement, signal amplification, and all those things are done using this black box, right? I have not shown the circuit of the black box, but it's very simple, very easy you can make in your lab. And then this blue and white part was purchased by the National Instrument, which is actually the company making the LabVIEW software. And this is DAQ. It converts the voltage and current into the equivalent digital parameter. And then this software takes care. Software is LabVIEW. This screen which you are seeing is LabVIEW. And that controls the current, measures the voltage, and done the plotting and extraction, data fitting, curve fitting, etc. In this part, right, in the software part. So all those five components, the transducers, I mean, of course, personal computer, the transducer, signal conditioner, DAQ, and the software are present in this photo, right? So this is a typical example of a virtual instrument which does IV characteristics of diode at different interval of temperatures as decided by the program, right? You can add dimensions. You can, suppose you want to add the pressure also, you can do it by putting an autoclave and automating it. And you can put light if you want to do photoconductivity and control the light intensity also in the same experiment, right? So a lot of things can be done in the same experiment. The same experiment today can be doing the temperature dependent IV. Tomorrow, the same experiment with almost same setup, just an inclusion of light source, can do the photoconductivity for me. And both these experiments are of great importance if you are doing material science and some device physics, right? So this is what I mean when I say that virtual instrumentation can have lots of functional flexibility. All right. Now, how do we do this, right? We do it on LabVIEW. So virtual instrument hardware part will be covered again tomorrow in the demonstration. But let's go to the software part and see what LabVIEW is and how does it look like? What are the components? And this is, will be very interesting because, you know, if you have done any other programming, be it C, Fortran, or even MATLAB or you know, any other programming, you will be easily able to kind of, you know, sense what I mean to say by LabVIEW programming tools, right? So let's see what it is, right? LabVIEW is basically, I mean, the full form of LabVIEW is Laboratory Virtual Instrument Engineering Workbench. This is designed mainly to kind of, you know, talk to instruments. The main application of LabVIEW was to talk to instrument, right? It is basically a workbench, engineering workbench, where you can put several instruments and talk to them and synchronize them. So it's not a programming language as such, but there are programming tools included in it, right? And these programming tools are graphical. So it can allow you to do the graphical programming of your machine as well, right? So you have a machine, you have an instrument, you talk to them, and then you program them using the graphical method. So it's a graphical programming language for engineers and scientists. It's a powerful software tool for designing test, measurement, and control systems. As I said, this is for the data acquisition. This is to acquire the data, right? So all the tests and measurements are done using this LabVIEW. And it's a development platform for automation, interfacing, data acquisition, and analysis. The same thing which I have explained over last 10, 15 minutes. Right? Now, you know, just to give the feel, just to emphasize upon the importance of it, the LabVIEW is not only used by academicians. The LabVIEW is actually used by the companies like Boeing, right? The Boeing, which is making all these huge aircrafts, they do all their testings of the aircrafts, like vibration test, their strength test, their autopilot test, right? All those tests and all those measurements are done using LabVIEW, right? Boeing is one of the biggest customers of National Instruments, which does test, I mean, this, which is doing tests and measurements of their instrument. The Ford, which has now stopped working in a lot of areas, but the Ford was one of the biggest customers of LabVIEW and the National Instruments card. Even NASA, right? NASA has lots of satellite and testing systems, right? They have their launch vehicle testing systems, their vibration testings, their thrusters, their trajectory control systems, and all the systems are tested and deployed using LabVIEW. So even in the laboratory, they test those vibrations and all using LabVIEW's cards and LabVIEW programs. And even during the operations, these thrusters, etc., are controlled in their real-life applications using LabVIEW. So LabVIEW is not just for academicians. It is used in industries. It is used in the high-end research labs around the world. And if you look at, if you go to the LabVIEW website and National Instruments website and look for the customers, look for the applications, there are some brilliant applications, some very interesting applications. I'll talk about some of the applications which are really interesting. I'll also show you some nice videos probably tomorrow where the LabVIEW is being used to do some real-time data acquisition and control. Right. Why should we use LabVIEW? Obviously, there are lots of interesting features, like it interfaces with real-world signals, analyzes data for meaningful information, display results in flexible manner. These all things are done by a single platform. It is high-level application-specific development tool, as I said. It's like, for example, Boeing is, it is having its all test laboratories completely customized for their applications, right? The same instruments and the same sensors would have been used by some other company in a different way using LabVIEW. So you can, customize your applications and make an entire test systems which is designed for your application only. So the such flexibilities are not available with many other test platforms. It has built-in data processing, data analysis, storage functions, and less software complexities. Why I am advocating this, or why I like to use LabVIEW, and why I like to advocate LabVIEW is the last one. It has a very less software complexities. We are particularly talking about the computational tools for physics, right? And we are physicists. We want to do physics. We are not software engineers. We are not hardware engineers. And we don't want to spend a lot of time remembering codes and doing coding, right? Let the coding be done by the computer people. We are engineers, or we are basically, application oriented people. We want to use a program. We don't want to write a program and write a brilliant program. We want to use a program. So, LabVIEW is one such platform where you don't have to be a very good programmer to do the programming. You can simply, it's kind of a plug and play things. You have those tools, you connect the wires just the way you connect a circuit, and that is it. That's how you do the programming. All the logical, numerical, arithmetic, and mathematical operations are done by using wirings, right? So it allows you to spend more time and energy to do the physics part than the coding part. And that's what I like about LabVIEW. That's why actually I do advocate this. By the way, this is not a free software. This is a prototype software by National Instrument. It is very expensive. The LabVIEW used by ISRO or Boeing or those companies, they use the industrial versions of the LabVIEW, and that's very expensive. But for academic purpose, there's a huge discount. 75% discount is there. So we have purchased our own departmental license of LabVIEW 2010 service pack. We need to update it. But even if we don't update, for example, I'll show you some examples tomorrow. And they are built on LabVIEW 10 itself, and they are quite okay. You don't need to be updating it so often. We have not updated it, but for our applications, LabVIEW 10 is sufficient enough. Right. Okay, now how do we program using LabVIEW? I'll show you how to make a program, a simple program using LabVIEW. So what we'll do is we'll, one by one see what a typical program looks like. So instead of showing it on the PPT, I'll open a program and we'll show you those things, right? So let's see. Okay, so it is installed in this PC, and I will just... So LabVIEW, this is 32-bit version. So LabVIEW 32-bit, this is the icon that I see, right? So when I click on this, the main panel opens up, right? It tells me the version of LabVIEW and all those things, right? Now, this is where I get an access to various applications, various files which I have made. The file of LabVIEW is called VI. Their extension is .vi. VI stands for virtual instrument. So basically, every file is a virtual instrument. every file is a virtual instrument. It is supposed to be an instrument that will do some measurements and control. Right. So I can open any of the one that I have made already, somebody has made already, or I can open a blank VI. Right. So when I open the blank VI, it basically opens a new program, the blank program, and it simultaneously opens two windows. One window is called front panel on my right, on the right of the screen, with the gray background. And then the other window with the white background is called the block diagram, right? So every VI has two components, the front panel and the block diagram. This is just like any instrument. As I said, this is a VI, virtual instrument. Every virtual instrument has two parts, right? One is the front panel where all the controls are there, all the displays are there, all the knobs and buttons and switches are there. So those knobs, buttons, switches are all available on this gray part, on this front panel. And the controls, the wiring of the front panel, like, you know, the wiring of the display, the wiring of those knobs and the buttons are done in the block diagram. So basically, you can assume that block diagram is the internal part of the box. The front panel is basically the top, the user interface of the box, right? So a virtual instrument has two parts. The front panel, it is written here, untitled one, front panel, because I have not saved it. It says untitled. Once I save, it will have the name of the VI. So untitled one, front panel, will have all the controls and knobs and everything. And then those wiring for these controls and knobs and displays will be done on the block diagram, right? This is called the block diagram. Now, on the front panel, there are two things. Okay, I'll show you here. On the front panel, when I right click on the front panel, the control panel opens. The control panel opens. And this control panels has two things, the controls and indicators, right? So every time I right click on the front panel, it shows me this control panel and it has some controls and some indicators. So I can categorize all the components on the front panel into two things, the controls and indicators. Similarly, when I right click on the block diagram, it opens the functions palette. So there's a control palette on the front panel and there's a function palette on the block diagram, right? So all the functions, all the mathematical operator, arithmetic tools, all the logical tools, various data processing tools, various programming tools are all available in the function panel or function palette, right? So these are the two major components. The front panel, when I right click, it opens the control panels. The block diagram, when I right click, it opens the functions palette. On the functions palette, what you have got is the programming codes for front panel, because you know every time I put something on the front panel, there is a corresponding code on the block diagram which needs to be connected. So that is generated, and then the wiring is done in the block diagram. So the front panel has controls and indicators, the block diagram has programming codes for front panel and wiring for data flow, and then there are controls, functions and tool palettes which are like this. So these are the controls and tool palettes. All those on the top part are the tool palettes, various tool palettes, right? So we will see one by one what are those tools available and what are the programming tools particularly available in the lab view. All right. So typically when I make a program, this is how it looks like. It has some graph. Okay, so let's do it on the real program actually. All right, I hope I'm visible and my screen is also visible. Let us make some nice instrument. All right, some instrument. Now, when I say some instrument, you can imagine an instrument in your mind. Let it be the ECG machine, right? Electrocardiogram machine, or some multimeter, digital multimeter. I hope all of you have seen a digital multimeter, right? Sabne digital multimeter dekha hai? और डिजिटल ऑसिलोस्कोप, चलो ऑसिलोस्कोप लेते हैं. सबने डिजिटल ऑसिलोस्कोप देखा है? Has everybody seen a digital oscilloscope? Is there anyone who has never used or seen a digital oscilloscope? Okay, Vinit Pandya has not seen because I-20. All right, I-20, obviously you've not seen a digital oscilloscope. Okay. Anyone else who has never seen or used a digital oscilloscope? Let me see if I have a digital oscilloscope in my lab. Just a second. Yeah, let me see if I have a digital oscilloscope with me. All right, by the time it comes, imagine a digital oscilloscope in your mind and tell me what do you see on the digital oscilloscope. उसके ऊपर क्या क्या होता है, लाइक जो सामने जैसे डिजिटल ऑसिलोस्कोप दिखता है तो उसके ऊपर क्या क्या चीजें होती है. व्हाट डू यू सी ऑन ऑन डिजिटल ऑसिलोस्कोप. स्विचिंग टू हिंदी समटाइम्स इज ओके राइट. एनीवन हु इज नॉट फेमिलियर विथ हिंदी एट ऑल, आई गेस नो. ओके सो वन और टू लाइंस इन हिंदी समटाइम्स जस्ट फॉर द फन विल बी ऑल राइट. टेल मी व्हाट डू यू सी, आई मीन व्हाट डू यू इमेजिन ऑन डिजिटल ऑसिलोस्कोप. Yes, channels, very good Karthikeyan, channels, there are channels. Then what else do you see on digital oscilloscope? Yes, Subhash. Yes, sir. What else do you imagine on a digital oscilloscope? They are available. Okay, not digital, normal oscilloscope. Let us take normal analog oscilloscope. What do you see? Triggers. Okay, then anything else? What else do you see on digital oscilloscope? Okay, I'll show you on my screen if it is not physically present. Screen, very good. It has a screen. Very nice. What else? What else do we see on the digital oscilloscope? We have got triggers, we have got channels, we have got screen. See, this is how it looks like, right? I just googled it on the website. So what do we see on a digital oscilloscope? There is a screen, right? There is a screen which has the graph on it. Then there are some knobs, some circular knobs. There are some push buttons which you can press. There are some input channels, very good, right? Then there are some triggers and so on. You can have various push buttons, various knobs, various switches, right? So all these things are there. You got screen, you got some indicator LEDs as well. There will be some LEDs somewhere which tells that, yeah, this is it. Here you have an LED which tells that the machine is on. There is a main power button here. So you take any oscilloscope, let it not be digital, even normal oscilloscope, it will have a screen, some knobs, some input channels, some push buttons, some toggle buttons, some switches. Right, these are the typical things you will imagine on any instrument. Now, as I said, in LabVIEW, by using LabVIEW, you are trying to make an instrument, right? So basically, it should have all these functions, right? All these features. It should have a screen which can present a graph. It can have a screen which can put an image on it. It should have some knobs, it should have some buttons, it should have some push buttons and toggle switches and different types of switches, right? All these are on the front panel, the interface basically, where you can, I mean, when you, where user can enter the data and see the things. So you see, excuse me, on any oscilloscope, on the front panel, you want some knobs and switches and push buttons and toggle buttons and screens and displays and LEDs and all those things. So similarly, for the same reasons, for the very reason, on the front panel of LabVIEW, you will have all these things, right? you will have all these things. For example, you need to put some knobs, right? So here is a knob. I can make it bigger, smaller, the way I want. Okay, I might have two knobs. I might have some meter like this, right? Which is basically sensing something. All right. Then I might need some graph, for example. Like I'm trying to make an instrument, right? And as I said, you can imagine any instrument. What are the things you need on that instrument? You need some display, some graph, or some chart, something like this. Okay. Then you need some toggle switches, main power button, maybe something like this. Right. So this is a toggle switch. What else do you need? You might need some push buttons, some sliding switches like this. Like this, right? So these are the typical things you require on the front panel of any instrument, right? Imagine a digital oscilloscope or something like that. These are the typical things you require on the front panel. Some gauges, some knobs, some text button also, right? Some values you want to enter. So you might want to enter some numeric value. You might want some indicator as well, which displays something. You might want some LEDs. Like this. Okay, so this is an LED which may glow depending on some parameter. So this is a typical front panel of an instrument. It has switches, it has meters, it has knobs, it has graph or displays, it has LEDs, right? All these typical things you require on a user interface. So this is a front panel. Now, every time I put something on the front panel, what it does is it creates the corresponding code on the block diagram. So everything that I put here, for example, I put a knob here, automatically, the moment I put a knob here, it created a knob on the block diagram, right? The moment I put a gauge, it created a block diagram. I mean, a code in the block diagram. The moment I put this toggle switch, it created a Boolean switch on the block diagram, right? The moment I created this LED here, it created a Boolean indicator on the block diagram, right? So everything that I generated on the front panel, it automatically generated a corresponding code in the block diagram. And this is where it is user-friendly. You don't have to write a code. You know, all those typical functions you need, or typical features you need on a front panel of an instrument, basically, remember, you know, the back of the mind, you remember this bottom line that we are creating an instrument. We are creating a virtual instrument, which basically will be a common platform for multiple physical experimental instruments I have in my lab, right? So I'm creating a virtual instrument. And this, all the features which I want on my front panel are available. The moment I put them, the code for the same is generated automatically. I just have to connect the wires, right? I don't even have to specify the dimensions and all those things for the display. It automatically takes it, and it's plug and play. Like, you know, I can make it bigger, smaller, the, you know, whatever the size I want. If I want it to be big, I can simply drag it and stretch it and make it bigger. I can make LED as big and as long and as circle as I want, right? So everything is done here. The corresponding code is automatically updated. You don't have to write a code for it. You don't have to write a program for it. You just pick and place these controls on the front panel. As I said, there are two things, the control and the indicators, and the corresponding codes are automatically made in the block diagram. You can switch between the block diagram and front panel by double clicking on this. So I can simply double click on this. And it will take me to this, right? I mean, it will take me to the block diagram for it. Like this. So, you know, wherever I double click, it will take me to that control. If I double click here, it will take me to the function of it, right? So these are the things generated. Now, see, all of this on the front panel can either be, as I said, there are two things. It can either be a control or an indicator. Everything on the front panel is either a control or an indicator. either I am controlling some event or some parameter on the front panel, or I am reading some event or parameter on the front panel, right? So this is automatic. Like this one, this knob is a control, right? I want to control something from here. I'm basically increasing or decreasing some parameter using this scale. So this is a control. This is a control. And the corresponding block on the block diagram will have an arrow outside on the block diagram. So basically it is an input to the program, right? A control is an input to the program. I will decide the value. I will feed this value to the program. So this is an input to the program. And since it is an input to the program, the block diagram will have an arrow on the right hand side. I'm basically feeding some data through this pin. The gauge is an indicator. The gauge is an indicator, right? I am reading something out of this thing. And because it is an indicator, the block diagram will have an input arrow, you know, which will read the data from the block diagram and display on the panel. So this takes the data from the program and displays on the front panel. So it has an input arrow on the left hand side. So the arrow direction will tell me whether this is a control or an indicator, right? See, the Boolean switch is a control, right? The user will decide. Control means user controls the value of it. User will decide whether this is on or off. This knob is a control. User will decide what value I want to feed to the program. Whereas this gauge is an indicator. It takes the value and displays it to the user. So it is an indicator. It indicates the value of something. LED is an indicator, right? It indicates whether something is on or something is off. So it has an arrow on the left hand side. Waveform chart is an indicator. It displays the value on the front panel. And so the block of it, the code of it has an arrow on the left hand side, taking the data from the program. So it might look a little odd or awkward right now, but you know, if you use the LabVIEW routinely, this will become very clear to you. Right, the control will have an arrow on right hand side, the indicators will have an arrow on the left hand side. You can make anything convert into control. You can convert anything into control, you can convert anything into indicator. So you know, I can have this knob as an indicator as well. Although it doesn't look good, I can do it simply by right clicking on this. I can simply right click on this and change it to indicator. The moment I change it to indicator, the arrow position will change, right? I can change it to control. So I can make a knob as an indicator, I can make a knob as a control, I can make a knob as a, I can make a gauge as an indicator, or I can make gauge as a control. So control and indicator are simply the software functions, but you know, this arrow position will indicate whether this is a control currently or it is an indicator currently. I can simply right click and change it to control or change it to indicator. I can also make it to constant value. So we will see when we do some simple programming using this. Now let's make a meaningful program, something useful, something meaningful, right? Typically, imagine that, okay, I have deleted everything. Just select and delete everything. That's it. Imagine that you have some company, some automation plant, some factory where there's a boiler, and that boiler has a heater which is heating the content inside it, right? And now you want to control the temperature of that content, right? There's a boiler, you're heating something in the boiler and you want to control the temperature. Let us say some chemical reaction is taking place and you want to control the temperature to certain degrees Celsius, 180 degrees Celsius, something like that, right? There is some application where you have a boiler, there's a heater, and you want to control the temperature of the boiler. Now, you want to write some simple program which does it, right? Obviously, you require the hardware for it. You require a physical heater because your software, your computer will not be able to heat anything. You require a heater. You require temperature sensors like thermocouple or something like that. You require pressure sensor as well if it is a boiler. Then, right, so these are the typical things you require. Let us assume that you have those transducers, the heater, the temperature sensor. They are connected using the conditioner, signal conditioner, DAQ device to your computer, right? Now you want to program it. So all you have to do is, obviously, you want to kind of, you know, have a set point. So you want a numerical input like this, where I will say that I want to set the temperature to something, set point. I want to set the temperature to, let us say, some amount of Celsius, right? Let us say I want to set the temperature to 180 degrees Celsius. That's where I want to have my boiler all the time, right? Now, this is a control, right? I am controlling it. I am feeding the value. So the moment I put this set point temperature control, it created a code for it on the block diagram. And because it is a control, the arrow is on the right hand side. So whatever the value I feed will be available for me to use in the block diagram from this wire. Now, there is a thermocouple which is actually measuring the temperature from the boiler and feeding it to me, right? So there is some, so now I'll just simulate it, right? Ideally, you should have it, but I'll just simulate it. I'll just say that, okay, I'll put this knob like this. So this assume that this is an actual temperature of the boiler, which is measured by some sensor. Since I don't have a boiler and a temperature sensor here, I'll just, you know, simulate this. Right, when I, and let us say it is going up to 200. Now I don't have to code it. I'll just double click on this. Instead of 10, I will write 200 and it will adjust the scale accordingly, right? So now it is up from 0 to 200. I can also do all those things like, you know, what is the spacing between this scales and all those things I can do by right clicking and going to the property, and I can change, you know, what is the major tick, what is the minor tick, just like you do it in the Excel or Origin, same way, right? Scale. So I can decide what should be the major tick color, minor tick color, display. I mean, how does it look like? What is minimum? Zero. I can also have minus 100 to plus 200. That is also possible. All these things can be done by simply right clicking and going to the property. Anyway, that's not important. Data type also, like, you know, whether I want integer, I want double, just like in C, you decide the data type, right? Similarly, you can have the data type here. It can be numeric, it can be even text, right? Whatever data we want to feed, we can select from here. We can select the scale, logarithmic, inverted, linear, all those controls are available. Display format, you want it to be floating point or exponential, I mean scientific or automatic formatting, it will decide based on the scale. All these things are available. How many digits you want to display after the decimal point, right? How many significant digits you want to display. So all those controls are available in the knob properties. You can select from here, right? But anyways, you can, you know, for now I will go up to 200 because 180 is set point. I can go up to 500 or even 300, whatever I want. This is the knob, right? This assume that this is the temperature measured by a thermocouple in the real boiler. And this is my set point, right? Now I want to take some decision. What is the decision? I'll just compare the value which is measured by the thermocouple with the set point. And if my set point is greater than the value measured by the thermocouple, then I want to turn the heater on. Otherwise, I want to turn off the heater, right? So what I'll do, I'll just compare. Now, on the block diagram, when I right-click, as I said, the function palette's open, and it has all these, you know, functions, the numerical functions, comparison functions, logical functions, basically, all the structures like loops, for loop, while loop. So, you know, every tool that you require in a programming, every tool that you require in any typical program in C or Fortran or MATLAB are available here, but in graphical form. So you have a comparison palette where all the comparison tools are available, equal to, not equal to, greater than or equal to, less than or equal to, is it equal to zero, not equal to zero, greater than zero, less than zero. So, you know, all the typical comparison palettes or the typical comparison functions that you want to do on your data, numerical data, are available here. Now here we want to, you know, do something like we want to compare the set point with the actual measured values. And we want to see whether the set point is less than the knob, the less than the measured values or not. If it is less than the measured value, we want to turn off the heater. If it is greater than, the set point is greater than the measured value, we want to turn on the heater, right? So simple. We want to measure the temperature, compare it with a set point. And if the set point is greater than the current value, we want to turn on the heater. If set point is less than the current value, which means the current value has exceeded the set point, then we want to turn off the heater. So this actually, this is a very complex algorithm in real time. There are PID algorithms available, and we can implement a PID algorithm here as well. But, you know, we will go to that level later. We'll, for now, we'll just want to turn on or turn off the heater, depending on whether the set point is greater than or less than the measured values. This is like a refrigerator or an air conditioners at your home, right? In your air condition, you set the temperature to 24 degrees Celsius. Like we just set the temperature to 24 degrees Celsius, and then the current value of the room temperature is measured by a thermocouple. As long as the current value of the measured temperature is less than the 24 degrees Celsius, the cooler, because it is a cooler, air condition is typically a cooler, it might be a heater sometimes, but mostly it is a cooler in countries like India. So if I want to, I mean, if my current value of temperature of the room is less than the set point, I don't want to cool, so I'll turn off my AC. The moment that current temperature of the room goes beyond the set point, which is 24 degrees Celsius, the moment my room temperature is higher than 24 degrees Celsius, which is my set point, the heater should be on. So I'm simply comparing the two and take the decision. Right, now I'll go to the comparison palette and take greater than or equal to. It has two inputs, X and Y. As long as the set point X is greater than or equal to the knob, which is the measured value, we are simulating it, the output will be true. The output is a Boolean function. It will be true. So it is asking a question. If you keep your cursor here, it tells me what it is doing. It is asking a question. Is X, which is upper input, greater than or equal to Y? Yes or no? If the answer to this is yes, the output is true, logic true, right? Boolean true. If the answer to this question, is X greater than or equal to Y, is false, the output will be false. Now, this could trigger some relay, some switch, right? It can be a digital switch, right? Basically, if I'm connecting some instrument here, there'll be a pin which will create the output true or false, you know, so I'll connect some digital output here, and that will connect the true, that will create the true or false output, and that will be connected to some relay, and that relay will turn on or turn off the heater. But since we are simulating, what I'll do is I'll just, you know, put an LED here, and the LED will tell me whether the heater is on or off. How do I put an LED? I can simply go to the front panel, right click, go to LEDs, and decide which type of LED do I want, right? I'll simply take simple LED. The moment I took an LED on the front panel, the code for it is created. It is an indicator, so the arrow is on the left side. And all I have to do is simply connect the output of this function to the input of this. That is it. I have connected, right? So now you can simply, I mean, so this output will tell me whether the set point is greater than or equal to the measured value of temperature, which I will simulate through this knob. Right? I hope you're getting it, right? I'm trying to simulate a real-time temperature. Obviously, I don't have the boiler here, so I'm trying to, you know, I'll tell that the measured temperature is this, something like that. All right. Now, I can run the program using this arrow button. So I'll simply run this, and it has compared the set point with the actual value. What is the actual value? Somewhere around 0, right? Somewhere around 0 and 10. So the actual value is around 0 or 10. And the set point is 180. Since 180 is greater than or equal to the current value, the LED is on. This LED would have been in real life replaced by a relay, and that relay will turn on the heater, right? Now, the moment I turn on the heater, this will increase, right? The current temperature will increase because heater is on. And see, it is showing me 53, 57, 58, 62, 69, 90, 180. The moment it reaches 180, the LED will go off, but I will not be able to see it in real time because program is not running, right? Program is not running. I'll just go up. At 158, currently it is 160. If I run the program, the LED will still remain on because this will still produce true because the set point is still greater than or equal to the current value. However, the moment I cross 180, now it is 183, right? 184.9. The moment I cross 180, now the current measured temperature of a boiler, which is displayed by this knob, is greater than the set point 180. And so the relay should turn off, the heater should turn off. I don't want to heat it anymore because I have reached the set point. And so if I run it, I can simulate, right? I run it and the LED went off. अच्छा, ये तो मैं क्या कर रहा हूँ, बार बार रन करके चेक कर रहा हूँ प्रोग्राम. इन रियल लाइफ दिस इज नॉट हाउ यू शुड डू इट. यू शुड हैव सम सॉर्ट ऑफ कंटिन्यूअस अपडेट, राइट? मोस्टली यू नो इन रियल टाइम ऑटोमेशन इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स और ऑटोमेशन एप्लीकेशंस वी कंटिन्यूअसली अपडेट अवर इनपुट्स एंड आउटपुट्स. सो टू डू दैट व्हाट शुड आई डू? एनीवन हु डज प्रोग्रामिंग विल टेल मी व्हाट शुड आई डू सो दैट आई कंटिन्यूअसली अपडेट दिस वैल्यू एंड कंटिन्यूअसली अपडेट द आउटपुट. या व्हाट शुड आई डू? I should put it in a
loop.
Yeah, I should put it in a loop. Very good. I should put it in a loop. I can choose either a for loop or a while loop. Which one should I use? What is the difference between for loop and while loop? Of course, we will discuss it later also what difference there is between the for loop and while loop. But just you know, because all of you have already done some sort of programming somewhere, C or Fortran or something. Yeah, what is the difference between for loop and while loop? Anyone? You use loops in Fortran, in C, in MATLAB also, right? So what is the difference between for loop and while loop? Anyone?
Actually, in while loop, there is a some certain condition is reached, then it's stop working. Up to that condition, it's continue going on.
Okay. And for loop? Yes, Channi, in for loop? What is the for loop? So, okay, so the difference between the for loop and while loop is a for loop, you tell how many times it will run, right? So before starting the loop, you decide how many times the loop will run. That is called for loop. You know, the condition is placed before starting the loop. So you say that the loop will run for 20 times, right? So it is pre-decided that the loop will run for 20 times. So whenever you know how many times you want to run the loop, how many measurements you want to take, if it is pre-decided, if it is known prior to running the loop, then you use for loop generally. The while loop is like a fan. It keeps running until you turn it off or until some condition is met, right? So when the condition is not known in advance, at what time, at what iteration the condition will be met is not known in advance, then you use while loop. If you know in advance how many times you need to run the loop, you run a for loop, right? So, you know, depending on application, you either choose a for loop or a while loop. If the number of iterations you know in advance, you run a for loop. If the number of iteration is not known in advance, but some condition is known, then based on that condition, you run a while loop. In this case, because we are doing something continuously, we will use a while loop. How do you use a while loop? For all programming related functions, we will go to block diagram. Simply right click. There are structures. So in the structure, we have a for loop and we have a while loop. We'll simply click on while loop and put everything that we want to cover in the while loop. Right. So everything which is in this gray box is now inside the loop and will be iterated again and again and again until a stop signal, a true signal goes here. Now this is a loop condition. So when somebody presses the stop button, then only this loop will stop. Till then, the loop will keep running. Right. So what I'll have to do, I'll put a stop button on the top, on the front panel. When that button is pressed, the loop will stop. Alternatively, so there are all the buttons here, right? I can simply take any, I can take this stop button. So the stop button, I'll select from here. It will have its code in the back block diagram. Now this, I'll simply connect to the loop condition. When somebody presses this stop button, I can make it bigger so that pressing becomes easier. When somebody presses this, then the loop will stop. Until then, the loop will keep running. Right, and keep updating the front panel depending on the data. All right, so now, okay, I put the stop button from front panel. Alternatively, you can simply, okay, I can delete this. So there are multiple ways you can do the same thing, so just for the convenience. I'll delete these wires. I can simply go to the block diagram, right click here. Right, ये जो फिरकी जैसा दिख रहा है ना, फिरकी, फिरकी को क्या बोलते हैं हिंदी में? I don't know. What do you call it in English? So you know this thing. It has a wire in it. So I can connect the wire when I take this cursor on the arrow. Right. So when I right click under this condition, it says create constant, create control, create indicator. I can create a control, and that will create a stop button on the front panel. Right. So this is also another way of putting a stop button. I can put a stop button here. I can make it bigger. All right. So now if I run the program, since my controls and indicators are in a while loop, it will keep running. You see, the program is continuously running now. Now everything will be updated in real time. So the set point is 180 degrees Celsius. Current temperature is, yeah, now it is 156. So the heater is on. Heater is on. So temperature is increasing, 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 increasing. The moment it reaches 180, it has stopped. Heater is stopped now. So temperature will go up because of thermal inertia for a while, maybe 5, 6, 7 degrees Celsius, and then it'll stop dropping, 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 dropping. The moment it goes below 180, the heater is on again. It might go below down, I mean, because of thermal inertia, again it go up to 170, and then it starts increasing, increasing, increasing. The moment it crosses 180, it will stop the heater, right? So now it is in real time updating because everything is running in a while loop. Right, so everything is, and program is continuously running. I can make it more fancy. I can have some meter which will tell me the current temperature, because isme mujhe theek se dikh nahi raha. I can have some nice meter, some progress bar or some meter like this, which will tell me the temperature continuously inside. This is my current temperature, right? I'm just connecting the wires. So this will also tell me the current value of temperature. This meter will show me the current value of temperature. I'll again make it up to 300, so that, you know, from minus 100 to 300, let us say the same thing. Make it big. So this will show me the real temperature. I can also put some thermometer, something like this, right? This makes more sense when it is temperature. Again, same, minus 100. 300. Yeah. So all these things are showing me the same value, temperature. Okay. Just trying to make it fancy and so that it looks good to me. Okay, that's it. Same program. I'll just run it. See, current temperature is around 175. Right, both of these are showing 175. These are current temperature. Set point is 180. So it increases, increases. The moment it crosses 180, you know, this has stopped. So it will then again go down. Like this. All right, it is updating in real time. Okay, I can also put a graph and see the record the value of temperature just by putting it. Can be XY, I mean, simply chart like this, maybe. Yeah, here. You can keep updating the chart as well. You see, constant, right? I'm increasing. And decision making is done by means of this LED. I mean, I am trying to display that the decision is being taken by means of this LED. Instead of LED, it would have been a real pin that will turning on. They'll be turning on or off a relay, and that relay will be turning on or off the heater in the real life, right? So you see, this is a very simple program. I made it in 10 minutes in form of demo, and this is controlling the temperature. All I have to do is find out some DAQ device that will measure the value of thermometer, thermocouple from a boiler, and we'll have a relay which will turn on and turn off the heater, and replace this LED with that relay pin, and replace this knob with the incoming data of the temperature sensor. That is it. Everything will work, and this will then control the will control the temperature controller system or a boiler, basically, right? I can advance it by having some more mathematical operations on it. I can pre-decide when to, you know, just there are very interesting algorithms like PID algorithms which will take care of this thermal inertia, because in real life, I cannot have that oscillating graph, right? This would be an oscillating temperature. It'll go up beyond 180 because of thermal inertia. It'll go up to 185, 86. Then it'll start dropping. The heater will be turned on at 180, but then temperature will keep dropping because of thermal inertia up to 175 before it starts increasing again, right? So that might happen in real life, which could be dangerous. In boiler, it may not have the tolerance of 10-15 degrees Celsius of oscillations. So you can have advanced algorithms like PID algorithm, which will turn on heater a bit earlier. Take the decision and turn on the heater earlier and turn off the heater earlier as well to control the temperature precisely at 180 degrees Celsius. Those sort of algorithms are available in market, and those algorithms are even, you know, you can make it in program, or there are some tools which are available in LabVIEW itself, which, the PID tool is also available in LabVIEW itself, and you can simply use that code and make this program with PID also. So this is a very simple, simple example of how the VI looks like, right? Humne aaj naya kuch nahi sikha. I have just shown you how a virtual instrument looks like. How can you simply make some small instrument on the front panel and do the programming by simply connecting the wires like this, right? So let's quickly go to the PPT and see how it looks like. This is a very similar example of acquiring a temperature. I'm displaying the temperature on the front panel, also recording it in form of a chart, a temperature history, and this is just controlling the while loop. By the way, I did not show you how I turned off the loop. If I run it, it'll keep running. I'll keep updating the temperature in real time until I press the stop button, right? So when I stop, it stops the program. All right. Okay. And this is its block diagram. This is a while loop, just as I said, I made it right now, and I can do all those processings. Right. All right. As you saw, you know, there are control panels on the front panel, which has all the controls. So what I'll do is I'll just go through some of the controls and some of the functions. Function palettes are on the block diagram. Control palettes are on the front panel. And then there are some status toolbar, like program is running and program is continuously running, abort execution. All those controls are available. So we'll one by one see these controls maybe in next 5 minutes before we stop today, and we'll continue the discussion and make some more meaningful programs tomorrow using LabVIEW, right? But as I said, the take-home message today is this is how the LabVIEW program looks like. It can control a lot of applications. You can acquire the data and process it. So let us see what are the controls available here. So when I right-click, there are numerical controls. Numerical controls have basically some value I can enter. There's a fill slide, pointer slide, right? Then there are some different types of fill slides and pointer slides. You can enter the color, you can inject the color as well, right? You can have some color input. You can have a dial, you can have a knob. All these are numeric inputs, numeric controls. As I said, control is an input, right? So it has all numeric controls. Then it has buttons, a rocker button, that's like horizontal rocker, vertical rocker, slide switch, toggle switch, horizontal toggle switch, a push button, right? Some sort of text buttons like this, off, okay, cancel, stop, all these things. You can write whatever you want, right? Instead of okay, you can write launch, you can write trigger, whatever. Just, you know, put it here, double click it and say launch, right? So this button could be some sort of launch button, right? It is basically controlling some satellite launch vehicles, and when the ISRO director presses this button, it starts the launch, right? Something like that. And really, ISRO is also using LabVIEW as a control software, right? All right, so all sort of switches are there. Then there are text controls. You want to write something, you know, string control, text ring, menu ring, path control. So we will see what these controls are as we make the programs. Then there are user controls, like I can have some well-defined user-defined control. We will go into it at the later stage. Then there are indicators. Numerical indicators are, as I said, some meter, some gauge, some tank, thermometer, progress bar, right? Jise progress bar hota hai na ki kitna download hua. That sort of progress bars are there. So, and then numerical indicator, they'll just display the value as it is. There are some LEDs, graph, etc. There are much more. I mean, you know, there are motor controls, system controls, classic controls. So all, as I said, you know, you imagine an instrument, everything that you want on the front panel, every such control is available on this right click, on this front panel, just by right clicking, and the control panel will open. To control all this, you go to the block diagram, right click on the block diagram, and every programming tool, you know, just like imagine a C program or a Fortran program or a MATLAB program, every tool that you require to write a program is available by means of some icon here. Just select that icon. For example, for loop, while loop, then time structure. This will have some time loop, like how much time you want to run the loop, right? Some synchronization tools, some stop time and clear timing, and these are all timing related tools. Then there are case structures. For example, there are five cases. You know, in the equivalent to this in C program or Fortran program is if else or some sort of case structures, case 0, case 1, case 2, case 3. So this will select one of the cases depending on some input and run that or execute this, that case. Then there are event structures. For example, in high energy experiment, some event happens and you want to detect that event, this event loop will detect it, right? So this is an event structure. Then there are flat sequences. You want to run a program in sequence. So simply put it, everything that is in this structure will be executed first. Only after this is done, you have the next sequence. So you can, you know, you add frame after. So now you have another frame. So in LabVIEW, the data flow is always from left to right on the wire. So as the data moves from wire, it goes from this to this to this. So you can have n number of sequences, and this will take care of the triggering. For example, in a spectroscopy experiment, I want to first set up the wavelength, then measure the photocurrent. Again, change the wavelength, measure the photocurrent. So I will have a change the wavelength command here on the first frame, and measure the voltage, measure the photocurrent in the second frame. So that will always be in that sequence, sequence one, sequence two, sequence one, sequence two. And this entire thing can be put in a loop, right? So I can have this entire thing in a for loop, right? And then I can tell that this should happen for 10 times. So I can create a control and I can say that this should happen for 100 times or 10 times, depending on, or I can put some mathematical logic that, you know, the starting wavelength is 500, last wavelength is 1000, step is 10. So 1000 minus 500 divided by 10 will be the number of times the loop will run, right? So depending on some application, I can decide how many times this will run. So this loop will now run for 100 times, and this two will be executed in a sequence, number one and number two, number one, number two. So it'll go to a wavelength, measure the photocurrent, go to next wavelength, measure a photocurrent, go to next wavelength. It'll do it for 100 times in this sequence. So this is called a sequence structure, flat sequence structure. So these are all structures. Then there are array, right? All the array things which you can imagine or which you can do in C programming, those tools are available. Array size, index array, build array, find out a subset from an array, find out a maximum and minimum in a data array, right? You can have one-dimensional array, two-dimensional array. So you can have matrix also. You know, you can have a transpose of a matrix. You can, all the data that required to be manipulated in form of array can be done here in the array tools, right? Then there are clusters. Clusters are some advanced types of data processing, which we'll learn later. Numeric. So all numeric and arithmetic operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, quotient and remainder. You know, so any programming related arithmetic tools you want in your program are available. Increment, decrement, add array element, you know, then multiply array. So all these things, round towards the higher side, round towards the lower side, you know, right round to the next available number, absolute value, So scale by power, square root, square, negate, reciprocal, sine, every mathematical operation is available here. Even advanced data manipulation operations are available. Like, you know, you can have it converted to the digital and the binary and hexadecimal typecast can be done. So everything that you can do in C program or a Fortran program can be done here, but by means of a icon, by means of a graphical icon, right? So this is all numerical functions. You know, you can have, okay, you can have math constants as well, like pi and e, Planck's constant. Because this is a scientific and engineering programming language, Rydberg constant, molar gas constant, Planck constants, speed of light, these things are also available, Avogadro constant, all are available in form of math constants. Then there are fixed point theory related functions, scaling is available. So all mathematical things can be done. Then there are Boolean functions like AND, OR, exclusive OR, NOT, NOT AND, which is NAND, NOR, not exclusive, so NOR, XNOR. All these functions are available, right? Then string related operations. String means the text. So all text related operations. So we will, okay, tomorrow we will go to these tools one by one and we will use them so that you can get familiar to it. We will use some of them. Of course, there are thousands of such functions, so we'll not be able to cover all of them, but we will cover some simple functions which are frequently used by a programmer in a scientific or engineering related programming, right? Then this timing and comparison, we already used file IO. So what we'll do is tomorrow we will see some important tools, some important techniques, and some important ways of writing some clever programs. And we will take some examples in the next class, right? So we'll meet again tomorrow and we'll continue from here. We'll take one by one and understand what this tool will do. All right, so I think we'll stop here and continue this discussion tomorrow and take some examples as we learn some more tools in the LabVIEW, right? As I said, this will kind of give you an idea about what LabVIEW is. Obviously, you will not become an expert of LabVIEW after 3 hours or 3.5 hours or 4 hours, but you will get an idea of what you can do. We will see some nice examples, and and then if you are interested, you can explore more. This is something you can learn on your own. You don't need a tutor or you don't need some classes. You can simply, I'll tell you how you can do it by some examples. And just to complete this today, I'll show you one nice program, a ready-made program, before we stop the class today. That program is Moon Landing. This is a game. This is a game called Moon Landing, prepared by someone like you and me. And LabVIEW has uploaded it in its package. You can go to help, find examples. It is something called find examples. This PC is very slow, so it will take some time. But anyways, it will open up. You can search an example of moon landing. Right. So this is okay. This is a ready-made VI made by someone. It is a game. Okay, I'm showing you a game, but it has a nice use of all the controls and indicators. And because it is a game, it is easier to understand. So I'm using this as an example. All right, is it visible? Have you ever played a game like this? Moon landing? Oh, this is nice HTTP, huh? I'm basically showing you a game, isn't it? Want to play this? All right. What is the objective? It's simple. You know, what is moon landing game? It's following. As we run the program, something will start falling off from 10,000 meter height. Right, something, and this chart will show me the altitude, right? Y-axis is altitude, x-axis is just time. So, you know, something will fall down. The gravity of moon is used to write this program, right? It's like not the gravity of moon, but some random number, 5 meters per second, just randomly. It is falling at 5 meters per second. It is falling at some gravitational constant, and then it is dropping from 10,000 meter. Altitude decreases slowly, and then I have this power. It is a thruster. So I increase this. This will basically create a thrust towards upper side, like towards upward, right? Basically, I'm turning on the engine. So have you ever seen this? Kya naam hai uska? Vertical rocket, landing system, you know. It Tesla wala kya hai banda? Kaun hai? Huh? SpaceX? Yeah, so SpaceX has their vertically launching rockets, or sorry, landing rockets, like. So it has this downward thruster. So basically it stops it falling from, I mean, stops it from falling freely, right? So this is a thruster. As I turn on the power, I can go up to 100% power, and thruster will be working at its maximum one, and that will stop it from falling, right? But then it will also utilize the fuel. But I need to reach the ground, which is zero altitude, before I am running out of the fuel. So I'll have to use my thruster judiciously. That's what the game is all about, right? This is showing me the height. This is showing me the speed at which it is falling, and this is the final approach. Just in last, the condition is that I should land. That means, you know, I should reach to the zero within the speed of 5 meter per falling speed of 5 meter per second. I should not land with the speed higher than 5 meter per second. Otherwise, it will crash, right? So I should not be crash landing. That's the game is all about. So I have started the game, right? The height is decreasing from 10,000. The speed is increasing because it is an acceleration, right? I mean, DX, basically it is falling with an acceleration speed. Fuel is 50,000 unit, but now I need to turn on the thruster. Otherwise, the speed will be so high that I'll not be able to control it. The moment I have turned on the thruster, the speed with which I am falling has now started reducing, right? Reducing, but then tank has also been getting empty, right? Now it's less than last 1,000 feet. But the thrust is so high that it has now started saturating. So I'll again let it fall down. We'll try to control the speed so that the speed is less than 5. Okay. I crashed at 38 meter per second, right? Which is too high. So it was a crash landing, right? I did not successfully land it. But this was the first time, you know, I can do it again. And eventually, yeah, again, it is falling. So with some practice, you know, you can land with the speed less than 5 meters per second. Okay. I'll typically go up to less than 3,000 meter height and then fully turn on the thruster. Boom. Okay, so I'm not going to optimize this, but with maybe 5-10 runs, you can control. This is a game. It is highly addictive, but anyways, I'll not go into this. This is how the program looks like, and this is made by some beginner. This is not a great program. Very simple. You can make it after just maybe a couple of days of practice. You know, so you can write a program like this with just a couple of days of practice and make a game of your own, right? This is actually a tip. A simulator, a trainer, like if you are really into this training of similar landing is done like this only. You know, have you ever seen a simulator in movie? At least I think if you have seen Apollo 13 movie, they have had that simulator which was similar to this, right? How do you control the angle of the entry point and all? They are simulating using similar things. So exact you know, panel that those people have on board is generated, and then using those thing one can train. So anyways, this is one program people have made. There are lots of such examples available, so you can learn using this, and we will see some more tools by which you can learn programming, but you can make some nice interactive programs. That's what I wanted to show you. So thank you so much for the patience. We have 4:13 already, so we'll stop here and we'll continue the discussion from here. We'll try to make a program like this slowly, build up a program slowly like this before we go to some applications like image processing and all in the last class. So thank you so much for listening to me. I'm going a little fast because I want to cover a lot of things. But as I said, it is not to teach you LabVIEW. It is just to give you a flavor of what you can do with it. And then you can learn if you have interest and applications. So thank you so much. See you again tomorrow. Bye-bye. And yeah, that's it, I think. Over to you, Channi.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Yeah, if there are some questions, we can discuss.
Yes.
Yes, Himanshu, sir, you were saying something?
No, sir.
And anyway, we have, you know, two more sessions tomorrow, so you can have your questions. By the way, sorry, I did not tell you. This is the trial version is available for free. Like you can go to National Instrument, download the trial version of it, and you can take, I think, 7 days or 30 days trial. And let me show you Western Instrument. Right. So you can simply, from National Instruments website, you can download the trial version and install it for learning. And then, you know, if you are interested, we have this licensed version with us, and we can do some nice programming, right? Yeah, I think. Orders, company support, leadership. I don't know. Yeah, downloads. They have changed this user interface. I have not gone to this for quite a long time now. So application software and AI drivers. All right, so simple, let you download. So this is where you can download, depending on what Windows you are using, 32-bit or 64-bit, whatever it is. You can download and then start a trial version for 30 days. And then you can activate it if you have purchased the license. So you can simply go to the National Instrument website and download the trial version. You can download it, not a problem. And then you can learn a lot of things from it, right? So yeah. So yeah, it'll be great if you want to try it along with me in the session. You can come prepared, download the trial version, install it, and yeah, then uninstall later on. Sorry. Yes.
Yeah. So I think if we do not have any further questions, then we are here to end the session. So this is this was the last session of day one. With this, I thank all the participants for participating here. And tomorrow we'll again start the session at 9:30 a.m. with the Origin Lab. And then the second session and third session will be on LabVIEW. So yes, if you wish to have hands-on experience, you can download the trial version or the student edition of these software and do practice along with the session as it goes on, right? So again, I thank all of you, and tomorrow I'll again share the link for the day two sessions. So yeah, thank you, Vipul sir, for giving such a nice presentation. So it was very nice, and yes, we will be getting more of this LabVIEW.
Some more games tomorrow. Thank you.
Yes. Okay. Thank you all.